Welcome to Freethinker Radio on KPFT Houston. My name is Derek Bros, and I'm here with Mike Jackson.
Hey, 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 day before the winter solstice. Hope y'all are having a great one. That was Carpet in the Drapes with Let's Get It On, a cover that they performed at Chill Vibes. It's kind of different than their usual thing. They'll be out at Union Tavern this Saturday, so if you want to check out what they really got going on, then get out there. Glad to be here. Glad to be on KPFT. Hope y'all are having a wonderful day. How are you doing, Derek?
I'm doing good for the most part. It's been an interesting weekend for me. I had a weird neck injury thing going on, so I've kind of been incapacitated the past few days and haven't really been able to do anything other than just lay around and groan in pain. But other than that, I'm alive. It's another beautiful day in Houston, and it's another week to educate ourselves about the world around us and to find ways to pursue solutions, not only for the big problems, but for the problems in our own city. So I'm happy to be here and hear good local music and chat with our audience. I'm hoping that today we'll actually get some calls, you know.
I think we're gonna
we're opening the lines up for you guys, just to let you know, remind you, you're listening to KPFT's HD3 dial, and our number is 713-526-8737. If you want to call in at any point during the show, we like to discuss local Houston news. We play some music from Houston artists as well as artists that we work with around the country. And then we get into national, look at the international scene. We try to focus on solutions. We've got a short interview Micah did earlier that'll be playing later on in the show. And so as far as just catching you guys up with what the Houston Freethinkers have been up to, which is, of course, the activist community that we work with and sort of funnel information through for Freethinker Radio. Well, it's the holidays coming up, so it's kind of a slow time right now. But there is a planned documentary screening on the 29th, December 29th, at Midtown Bar and Grill to help continue to remember John Trudell, who passed earlier this month. And we remembered him in our episode last week that you can find at the KPFT archives on their website, kpft.org/archive. And we'll be playing the documentary Trudell at Midtown Bar and Grill, talking more about John Trudell and his life and some of the things he was about. So you can join us for that. And then
that's a pretty comfortable environment there. People can sit down, they can order food, they can, you know, have a drink besides alcohol or alcohol if they want it, and enjoy a movie in the company of some friends. So, you know, it's great to have these documentaries there, because, you know, they're conducive to conversation, especially after the you know, the screening, because people have questions, they have concerns, and it's ripe for dialogue.
Absolutely. And you can find that. That'll be posted on the Houston Freethinkers Facebook page and Facebook group, as well as the HoustonFreethinkers.com, where we post all of our events and upcoming things. And as far as other things going on that we're involved in related to the Freethinkers and just our upcoming events, next Monday we will have a radio show. And there will actually be a show joining the airwaves right before us. So if you want to tune in earlier from 2 to 3, I can't remember the name of the show. I do apologize, but check it out. Maybe you'll enjoy it. And you can cruise on from them right into our show from 3 to 5. And then if you want to keep listening to KPFT after our show ends, switch to the FM dial, or maybe even on both dials they have it. And Democracy Now! Starts right after our show ends. So there's a good little block of shows to listen to. But next Monday on the Open Journal program, which is, of course, the morning program where individuals from the community can come talk about projects they have going on, I will be, I guess, a guest. Andy Smolsky, I can't remember how to pronounce his name. Sorry if you're listening and I'm pronouncing it wrong. But a friend of a friend who is also an activist and somebody who I consider to be an intelligent person just in the Houston community. I know that he cares about the issues he cares about, even where we disagree, and that's always good that people care about things and are concerned and looking for ideas. That's really what I'm concerned with. I was invited to come speak on Open Journal regarding, he has an essay he wrote about the small arms industry and gun control in general. And it's really, you know, this is a hot topic right now with, you know, something else we'll be talking about, I guess, next. We can probably talk about it today, but really we'll be talking about it again next week after we follow up with this interview. But he wrote this essay just talking about what he feels is the need to abolish all small arms in the entire world, you know, to destroy guns. And he lays out his reasoning. And, you know, there's definitely some things that I appreciate that he wrote. And I'm going to be coming to offer, I guess, a counter perspective, not in defense of the NRA or the small arms industry or anything like that. But I think it should be an interesting discussion. That's at 8 in the morning, I believe, is Open Journal, 8 to 8:30, somewhere around then. So if you're up early next Monday, you can check that out. And then more than likely, we can probably just replay that on our show that afternoon. So you can check that out. And the reason I say that this topic is important right now is because obviously gun control has been discussed, you know, the past couple of years, the entire Obama administration, and really for years, as gun violence seems to be more focused on. And also specifically in Texas, beginning January 1st, open carry will be legal in Texas, which I think people listening from outside of Houston and Texas are like, what, that wasn't legal in Texas? We figured you guys were just walking around with guns all the time on horses and with cowboy hats and shooting them at each other. But that's not necessarily the case here.
Stereotype.
Yeah, we didn't have it yet. And now open carry, which I think is a victory for certain gun rights activists. I know there's others who are really terrified of this. Just last week, there was an announcement from Metro saying that they will allow riders to open carry on the Metro rails, the buses. And I use the buses. I use a bus to get here today from my house over to the radio station. So I personally don't have an issue. Maybe this is the first thing you have. What are your thoughts on, you know, open carry coming to Texas? Do you think this is going to make things more dangerous, more safe? And this is something, a conversation will continue into next week as we get closer, because obviously next week will be the last show for the week or for the year before this goes into effect. So if you have something to say about that, 713-526-8737. Other than that, we, you know, looking ahead to January, it should be really busy. I'm anticipating by the end of this week, or for sure by the end, you know, the deadline's the end of this year, that I will have my documents back from HPD that you've heard me talk about before, this open records request to find out what type of monitoring they have done of the Houston Freethinkers, and, you know, if it involves Stingray equipment. And this has kind of been an ongoing thing between me and HPD, so I should have my documents, 800 pages is what I was told, by December 31st. So you will also get the first updates on those as we get closer and moving forward towards January 21st, when we're going to have another presentation on surveillance, cell phone surveillance. And one of the stories we're going to touch on in just a bit provides some more background. We continue to get, thanks to whistleblowers, we continue to get more information about the government's full range of surveillance equipment. So stay tuned, lots of information coming up. You want to dive into something, Micah?
Yeah, definitely. While you're talking about other shows on KPFT, I want to, you know, definitely shout out Night Sounds on, what is that, a Friday right after midnight, Saturday morning. Lisa and Jay, they've been supporting a lot of what goes on in the community, in the music community, for some time. This Saturday, they're going to have Solo Dollars, Dusty Bright Eyes Newman, and The Weeds on. And then next Saturday, they'll have D-Tray Val. So if you're heading back from Union Tavern Saturday, make sure you leave it on 90.1 so you can listen to that coming in, or wherever you are, you know. So we've got that going on. There's, you know, we got, I don't know, you want to dive into the local news or you want to take a break? I just wanted to make sure we continue to shout out all the people that had supported us and that have good shows here on KPFT, and like help expand the you know, your knowledge of the other shows here, so that you can just leave it on 90.1.
Yeah, we're going to go to a quick song, and then we'll be right back with some more news on Freethinker Radio here on KPFT Houston. Stay tuned.
Kill the last one of us, you never know. Oh, so beautiful. Kill you're so magnified. Looking at life through different lights, an altered perspective from behind these eyes, from behind these eyes.
Welcome back to Freethinker Radio. This is Micah here with Derek, and that was Cess, who will also be at Union, with a song she recorded earlier this year, Seminole. I guess we should get into some of the local. One thing I noticed earlier, you were talking about, you know, the gun control or, you know, just guns. We should play that song. I love that song, Guns, Yo, Yo. But yeah, nonetheless, I digress. Let's talk about guns. School district votes to arm some educators. I don't know how y'all feel about this, but this is happening in Johnson County here in Texas. The district will soon be allowed, some of the teachers will be allowed to carry guns. The Keene ISD board heard from parents Wednesday night and voted on the Guardian program. And basically, the superintendent there, Ricky Stevens, was against arming anyone inside the school. Now he says that the world has changed, and so is his opinion. School board members approved the policy that would allow few select staff members inside its four campuses to carry a gun. I kind of don't see, I mean, I guess do these ISD cops that pull people over and stuff not carry guns already? But nonetheless, you know, the school, it also said that the school would provide them with them, and let's see what else it says. The fear that a student might overpower a teacher and get a gun won't be an issue. People who are involved with kids at the, in that level will not be those who are selected to carry the guns. I guess they already know which kids are going to overpower them. I mean, what happens when Clark Kent just stands up and says, I ain't going to take it no more, and rips them glasses off and takes that gun away? But I'm not too concerned about this, you know. I think different school districts got to do what they got to do. And but I thought it was an interesting thing going on right here on the local regarding guns. And, you know, it's cause such a strange thing to be a hot issue in my mind. I mean, I understand people don't want to get people killed, but I just think it's a little jump to that. That's the only way people get killed. And earlier when you said that thing about ban all small arms, the idea of that, I've heard that, you know, and it sounds beautiful, but, you know, I don't want to sound cocky, you know, but it's really not that dang hard to make a small arm. You know, I guess how would you, you know, and that, you know, of course, that would go all into, you know, some sort of central legislation to do that and control to come and search your house like post Katrina and take your guns. So obviously that sounds horrible. So, but yeah, this idea, I think, like, if everybody just didn't need them, that'd be great, or didn't feel they needed them or whatever. Sorry.
You're cool. It's like I want to add to that, but I kind of don't want to, just in case he's listening, I don't want to give away my secret response to that, because
you got to tune in next time for Derek's take on that. So now we'll move right on to a different theme.
I definitely agree with you on that, which is, you know, it's just, I think that's something that will be added to the discussion.
I think it's often a stickier subject than it needs to be. You know, it's one of those buzz subjects type thing.
Well, let's continue with some local news. The Houston Police Department is asking for the public's assistance and efforts to combat the human trafficking and sex trafficking that happens in this city. If you weren't aware, Houston is known as one of the leading cities for sex and human trafficking in the United States. HPD officials wrote in a statement, "Human trafficking can occur anywhere, and there are many factors that come together to make Houston one of the major human trafficking hubs in this nation." It says, "The proximity to the Mexican border, the major international airports and shipping ports, the popularity of the city in attracting runaways, and the large sex industry are factors in contributing to this unwanted status. The department is asking members of the public who might be aware of people who may be victims of human trafficking or places where human trafficking may be occurring to contact the department's Vice Division at 713-308-8600. And I guess it says, in the meantime, the department is continuing their ongoing operations to continue to focus on those who are involved in this industry, either those who are selling or buying prostitution, human trafficking, sex services. Over the past month, vice officers with HPD have conducted sting operations in three locations in Southeast Houston. The operation landed 24 women in jail, the Houston Chronicle reported. And this kind of leads me to the next story, and then I guess a different topic. But before we jump over there, I do want to say that, you know, this is absolutely an important issue. you know, I think maybe it might be something that the Houston Freethinkers could do a benefit show around. We haven't done those in a while, and for all of our musician friends listening, you know, we used to, besides the regular shows we do in addition now, the shows we put on now, the Chill Vibes and others for the community, we also used to do monthly for the benefit shows with HFT and Visionary Noise together, focusing on, say, drug war or anti-war, you know, different causes, community gardening, human trafficking, you know, would be a great one. And finding a local organization that could benefit, getting a few of our favorite musicians and artists together to put on a show and raise money and raise awareness for an important cause. So if you're interested in things like that, please do reach out to us. And definitely if you have information on any of this, or if you know anybody, contact us, contact, you know, whoever you feel you need to do something about this. It's a horrible issue. That's, slavery is alive and well in 2015, to say the least.
Yeah, that's for sure.
And this leads to the other story they just mentioned, which I want to get into a bigger topic with you, Micah, and maybe some of our listeners. Houston police have arrested, what did they say? This was just Friday. Houston police have arrested 25 people in 3 prostitution stings in Southeast Houston between November 19th and December 15th. HPD officers conducted 3 stings around the Gulf Freeway and Howard Drive, arresting 24 men who asked to buy sex and 1 man who asked to sell it. First-time offenders will face up to $2,000 fine and up to 6 months in jail. Repeat offenders will face longer sentences. Authorities want to decrease local demand for prostitution, which funds sex trafficking, including of children. So by targeting patrons, the hope is to reduce demand for these illegal activities and the exploited women forced into them, HPD said in a news release. Federal reports have named Houston as a hotbed for sex trafficking, largely because of the interstate highways and international corridors. Okay, so they're saying that these guys, I mean, I don't know, it sounds like they were arrested for soliciting prostitution, which to me is a jump to, is, I'm sure there's definitely a connection, like they're saying here, to human trafficking, but I wouldn't necessarily want to include anybody who pursues prostitution as somebody who's also trafficking humans, because...
Well, that's similar to the argument before, that if you smoked a joint, you're funding Al-Qaeda. It's also similar to the argument that, it's just, you know, it's big net. It's ridiculous, because in some ways, you know, I think it's tied to this, because obviously, you know, prostitution exists in places throughout the world, and in some places where, you know, there's other standards culturally or whatever you want to say, within the culture, there's still sex trafficking. And then in other places where there's prostitution legal, without those same, with different standards in the culture at large, you don't have as bad a cases as of sex trafficking. But I do think, you know, what's happening is, it's just like I was saying earlier, because perhaps the people that are involved in prostitution in this area are overall also involved in sex trafficking. You know, it's kind of one of those things like with prohibition, where, you know, all of a sudden the gangsters are the ones that are, you know, able to provide the moonshine, you know. So it's a question, you know. I mean, obviously it's a moral question for an individual. I'm not so sure that it's a, you know, something that needs to be a crime, so that it's pushed into these sort of, what do you call it, you know,
into the
dealings.
Black markets.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, and I guess that's kind of what I wanted to get at, and, you know, curious of the listener, the audience's opinions and ideas as far as, you know, I just went on a little rant about how bad human trafficking is, so please don't confuse, you know, my next statements with supporting that. But I do think people who choose to offer sexual services in the marketplace, you know, what we call prostitution, that should be allowed, and individuals should choose to do that. And of course, what we're describing when it comes to these other situations is people who are being exploited, who are being forced, sometimes coming from other countries and then exploited and forced into these situations where they're promised all kinds of things, or, you know, just basically turned into sex slaves. Now, that is definitely nothing that I'm interested in supporting.
But yeah, I mean,
a free individual who is perfectly, you know, capable and in the situation to, you know, make their own choices and do so free of coercion, who choose to sell their products, whatever that may be, to me is perfectly fine. You know, no, to me, that's a victimless crime if an individual is choosing to do that. But that's not what we're dealing with here. And as you were saying, Mike, it kind of pushes people into those other areas where, since it's not done in a quote-unquote legal fashion, it's not necessarily as safe as it could be. It's not, you know, there's not a lot of competition. It's put in this area where you have to go into the, I guess, You have to go, if you want to prostitute yourself, you have to go into this part of town where that's where people do that, where people use drugs, where there's going to be pimps, where there's going to be, you know, illegal activity that kind of connects all that together.
A couple of things that are interesting about this, too, is I'm reading here that contrary to popular perception, most women in the sex trade are not foreigners, but Americans. A runaway teenage girl statistically will be approached by a pimp within 48 hours. One that is brought into the trade is often sent to a new city, so she will be unfamiliar with territory with anyone she knows to contact.
48 hours.
Mm-hmm. And see, that's another thing, is because of the situation it's in, if it was one of these things, I hate to even say licensed, but let's just go there. If it was one of these things that was licensed, or let's say condoned by the culture to be relegated to this or that house, whatever you want to say, you know, this location, then there'd be, you know, a whole different thing, because pimps and stuff like that out in bars or on the streets or wherever, was that Gulf Freeway or something? I don't remember.
Yeah.
they would, you know, that sort of thing wouldn't be the commonplace. It would be more like, you know, here's where you go for that sort of, you know.
There would be a place, and it probably could be done in a safer fashion.
Yeah, I mean, maybe they'd have to, you know, there's European countries, I guess, that used to license, you know, and do things like that. I mean, we got to look at the reality of things, you know. I mean, however you feel about this, I don't really believe that legality of, you know, or illegality of prostitution is really stopping anybody. It's just, you know, like with alcohol and prohibition in general, it's, you know, trying to legislate morality. And, you know, it's back to that question of the proper role of government, you know. And, you know, just think about it. On things you think are moral, a lot of people feel it's okay to go ahead and wield that sword, you know, and say, fine, this is illegal, you know. But, you know, they don't think about the unintended consequences, and they also don't like it when other people do that in contradiction to their morality. So it's, you know, I definitely think that these type of really touchy, emotionally charged issues, you know, are great, because they force us to look at, you know, what can we do about these issues, and, again, what is the proper role of the government in this? So you led with this story about the Houston Police Department, and what are they like actually trying to do, rather than just arrest the people that are breaking the law? What are they also trying to do?
They're trying to get the citizens to help.
There you go. I mean, the citizens to help, you know, how do we help with this? And that's a thing you mentioned, you know, a benefit show, and like you said, there's lots of things people can do. And One thing here says the first step is to recognize victims. Look for businesses employing more employees than they would realistically need, and especially young girls, not just in business settings, but also in residential areas, especially with rentals. They have a lot of people constantly visiting. Get to know your neighbors and report things that seem out of place. Report young women out by themselves after dark, loitering with no means of transportation. You know, it's one of those double-edged swords. You know, when you're right with these things, they're great. But, you know, it's also, is this the culture you wish to live in?
Where everybody's in fear and constantly, wait, there's a young girl. I have to go save her. She might be up to...
You know, and I think there's a point that I read here, too, that says the women are the victims and the real criminals are the pimps and the Johns. Yeah, you know, because I guess there's really nothing wrong with a free person doing what they want with their body. It's just illegal, but they're not real criminals. You know, the real criminals are the pimps and the Johns. The system is set up to help the prostitutes and punish the victimizers. In the case of foreign-born sex workers, they are often repatriated to their nation or refugee status if they can help prosecute the traffickers. For women native in the U.S., the agencies involved have programs to get them off of the street and return them to their families and friends. So educating yourself is another way to combat this scourge. United Against Human Trafficking provides educational seminars to churches, social workers, and police. Task forces at all levels of government provide educational materials and presentations for groups on how pervasive the crime is and how to stop it. The first thing of all of them would recommend, however, if you see someone at risk, call the authorities. The woman you see is a victim, not a criminal. And I think that's another thing to remember, I guess, like in the whole issue of, you know, prostitution. I mean, if this is the stance that's generally taken, the woman is a victim.
Yeah, instead of something, you know, it's putting her And obviously that's the case sometimes, but it's also taking away the ability for somebody to claim themselves and to be empowered through that act, you know?
Yeah, it certainly is in sex trafficking. You know, obviously, women can be victimizers in sex trafficking trade also, but, women, the individual, prostitute that's being used in sex traffic is definitely a victim. But, you know, does that mean that everybody who's engaged in prostitution has been a victim? You know, that's a whole different thing. So, you know, there's so many issues. And that's the thing is, if you just look at the surface, it just is like sex trafficking. But as you dig deeper, you know, it has these nuances and you have different considerations. You have to make distinctions, you know.
Absolutely. If you have anything to say about that, please feel free to call in at 713-526-8737. You are listening to KPFT 90.1 FM Houston on the HD3 dial, and this is Freethinker Radio. My name is Derek Brose, and I'm here with Micah Jackson, and we're talking local Houston news. This one is just something interesting. Houston man charged after shutting down freeway for marriage proposal.
Oh, that's just absolutely horrible. I mean, what an egoist, you know? What an egotist.
This guy says, love can make you do some pretty crazy things. Bringing a major interstate in downtown Houston to a standstill probably shouldn't be one of them. This 24-year-old dude has been charged with obstruction of highway, a misdemeanor, for shutting down 45 on Sunday to propose to his girlfriend, the Harris County DA said. The misdemeanor is punishable by up to 6 months in jail. I'm feeling bad, of course. I just wanted to apologize to everyone if I cause any problems, he told CNN. That wasn't my intention in the beginning. I just wanted to do something different.
Yeah, man, I want to do something different, too. But I don't know. You know, you got to think about it. People, you're stopping four lanes of traffic, you know? You really are kind of being inconsiderate there. I read a really scathing article in the Houston Press about it that I kind of liked because I'd seen the other article just about it. Like, there was this Sweetie article that came out to begin with, and I'm just like, yeah, I'd be so ticked if I was just sitting there waiting for them to, you know, do this thing. And then I saw the press article that's just like,
it's funny, like
yelling about
the guys, he posted a picture of him popping the question on Instagram. It says, when you shut down one of the biggest and busiest freeways in the entire country and you ask your girl if she wants to marry you, that moment is priceless. Love you, she said yes. And then it goes on saying
that's priceless.
in the video, you can hear people honking in the background in the proposal video, like, come on, just screaming at him.
I heard a off-duty cop passed him, too, in one of the articles I read, you know, like he was in the far left lane as they first were stopping it. And he went by, and he said at first he thought it was like a little incident of road rage or something. But then he saw that guy down on his knees, and he was just like, okay, and he kept going. But that's funny.
This is interesting, too. It says that he had eight friends and family members block cars, eight different cars block traffic so that he could make that happen. I think that's at least, you know, that's an accomplishment that not only were you able to do that, but you were able to convince eight other people to use their cars to block traffic.
Yeah, you know, if you can do this for something like that, and how much, he only had to pay how much? So, like, you could do this, you could get, like, eight cars, you could divide out the cost amongst you, and you could do this to, you know, for an effectively good party or, you know, to make a statement. I mean, basically, it's just
It makes me wonder, though, dude, because think about this. Like, every time, as long as I've been involved in protests and stuff, and, you know, since Occupy, we've seen some different people blocking down.
Were you arrested for this?
Well, yeah, we did a block the streets kind of entrance thing to the Federal Reserve in 2012.
No, I mean, you were, like, arrested for this very same thing, in a way. Not for trying to marry a woman on the road, but for using the road as a walkway or something? Like, I don't remember.
Some ridiculous charge. But what I wanted to get at, though, is that, you know, every time somebody does this, obviously the people were still upset with this guy, regardless of what he, you know, that it was a romantic idea or whatever in his mind. But, you know, it's funny to me whenever protesters get out there in the streets and they feel like, hey, we feel strongly enough about this issue, we want to interrupt your day and slow you down, you know. And, you know, we'll hear the same thing people say about this guy with the marriage proposal. Like, oh, God, get out of here. You're such an egotistical, you know, no matter what the issue is, even if it's an issue that you feel like 100% of Americans must, you know, have to care about this. This affects them. There will still be people like, why are you slowing me down from work? I don't care what you're here for. Get out of the street, you know. And I don't know. I just think that's an interesting conversation as far as where our interests are and when is it acceptable to interrupt your day, you know. We've all got busy things going on in our lives, and none of us want to be late for our appointments. But at what point is it acceptable to intrude upon another person's day as we're just out there living our lives, going about our business.
I don't know. People do it all the time saying hello and good day, and I just don't know about it. But then there's other times when like their car's on fire or they need a jump or something, and I'm just like, what's up with that, you know?
Well, what about slowing down, you know, like people who feel, whatever the topic may be, insert your favorite topic, and you feel... Because sometimes you get to
Well, they slow down traffic to let the churches out.
You know, you have to be obstructive. At some point, you might be like, well, look, no laws are going to help. I can't go through that system. I voted, blah, blah, blah. Maybe you get to the point where you're like, you know, this issue, the only thing that's going to stop them tearing down this building or whatever it may be is to physically, you know, interrupt.
Throw yourself up on the machine.
Put yourself on the machine. You know, I guess no matter what, you'll never be able to satisfy anybody. That's kind of the point. There's gonna
you
got to
know inside yourself. You can't really worry about
it. Matters to you, I guess. You know?
You can't really worry about what everyone thinks about it, but you need to worry about what the truth is on it. What do you know you can find out? You can't do things, you know, like this guy. Maybe he'd been a little bit more informed, like what it costs to shut down the roadway like that. You know, he'd probably make some other option or go ahead and decide that, you know, this marriage proposal was a once in a lifetime thing and he was going to do it. I mean, even something as trite and self-serving as that. I mean, you've got to think out, you know, you can't just go.
I think it's interesting though, as far as like evaluating your activities and as an activist and just thinking about, I try to think these days of what's effective, you know, what action should I take? And, you know, throughout the years, different things seem effective in those moments, you know, different things empower you in those moments. And sometimes I think upon reflection, there are certain activities and things that I've been involved in that have been self-serving in some ways, if not still for the cause. But it's interesting just then when you start to realize, okay, well, wait, I could go out and hold a sign and still do that. And sometimes, again, that's like that's the only thing you feel like you can do. I got to go just talk to somebody about this.
Yeah.
But other times, you know, it feels good to go out there to hold that and get a couple of honks or for people to say something to you. And either way, I feel like if you have a conversation, that's a quote unquote win. But, you know, you can think about, okay, well, I can go spend a couple hours doing that. Or maybe I can, you know, go spend a couple hours in some other form of activism, if you want to term it that. And just see which one brings you more, you know, productivity, which one you actually get the response that you want from, you know. They both can be effective. It's just, I don't know, I definitely evaluate that way these days. Like, okay, is this something that's just going to make me feel good? Like, okay, I'm getting out there making a noise, or is it going to accomplish the goals I want?
Exactly. And I think that's one thing that helped HFT, you know, is typically any issue that gets brought up and an action thought about, you know, usually someone says, you know, well, what's the objective here? What's the purpose? What do we hope to accomplish? You know, even everything from citizens' arrest of Kissinger to blocking the Federal Reserve entrances, the reasons that they're done, the takeaway that it'd be, you know, and it doesn't mean we can totally understand what'll happen once the action's taken, but it does definitely allow us to be more prepared, come off as more professional, because it's something that's thought out and not some simple, just passionate response to the injustices of the world.
Absolutely. You're listening to Freethinker Radio. Please stay tuned. We're going to go to a song from Crazy Music. I think we might go ahead and play two. Michael
more
wants to
music.
Play some more songs. Like you said, there's lots of things happening this weekend, so we'll be playing music by some artists that you might be able to catch around Houston this week. Stay tuned. We'll be back in just a few moments. This is Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT.
I'm
Welcome back to Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. My name is Derek Brose.
Yes, I'm glad to be here. Oh, these headphones are not the most wonderful. Hey, thanks for sticking with us. We definitely enjoy bringing you the music, and we enjoy being able to have a conversation, and we look forward to talking with you. So please call in to 713-526-8737. Sound off on one of these issues. Let us know what you think. Let us know some solutions. Let us know some other bands that you might want to hear. You know, so
what's on your mind? Talk to us
about
anything.
What's on your mind?
So I guess you want to go towards the bigger national picture?
Yeah.
Look at some stuff happening?
Yeah, let's progress. We're going to move forward. Chicago's happening.
All right. Yeah, you want to start there with Chicago?
Well, I guess if you haven't heard about the Chicago police officer, Jason Van Dyke, indicted on 6 counts of first-degree murder in the shooting death of a black teenager, then, you know, you just don't have a clue. You know, you already know Chicago's crazy, but yeah. So on top of it all, now several hundred protesters marched through downtown Chicago Friday calling for Mayor Rahm Emanuel to step down over complaints of abusive policing and lack of accountability in the police department. One thing that I think is interesting is, you know, this is a great time to go, you know, this is a good thing to maybe do, you know, when you feel like it's at that point, that might be a great thing to do, you know. The protesters, of course, chanting no justice, no peace, and wore t-shirts reading jail Rahm now. It was the latest in a wave of peaceful and mostly small protests in Chicago set off by the release of a video of a white police officer shooting dead 17-year-old Laquan McDonald, who was black, in October of 2014. One thing I think is interesting, and I wanted to hit on to for sure, is remember, the mayor is responsible for the police department. Last time we were talking about the police and the sheriffs, and we elect the sheriff. So, you know, if you ever wanted to be involved in local politics or wanted to be involved in politics that might make a difference to the people around you, remember that. I mean, the sheriff is the highest elected law enforcement officer, and the mayor just appoints the police. So, you know, it's kind of just, it's an appointed position. He's chosen by a politician and given a budget. So, you know, who do you hold responsible for what the police do? The mayor. You know, so it's kind of nice to see that Chicago is the latest U.S. city to see these types of demonstrations over deaths at the hands of police, so many of them caught on video. Chicago police killed an average of 17 people a year over the last 7 years, most of them African-American, and it is extremely unusual for police officers to face charges or to even be disciplined in such cases. It was not until the uproar over the video of McDonald being shot 16 times as he apparently walked away from the police that the Federal Department of Justice launched an investigation on civil rights issues in the city's police department. There needs to be accountability for the injustices that are happening throughout Chicago Police Department and in our justice system. A resident of the South Side suburb of Beverly who attended the march with her brother stated. And one of the things I guess that's to be brought up later. But nonetheless, I think, you know, it fits exactly with what you're talking about. Like, you know, when is there a time, you know, to move and to march and to perhaps even, you know, take to the street to affect change? And I think it's when you're not getting the response you need from the people that are supposed to be accountable for the actions. And of course, guess what? Emanuel's office did not respond for any request to comment. The mayor is not expected to heed calls for him to leave office, of course. And now he's basically being, you know, met different places with small groups, of course. It's always a small group of protesters, right? In America, at least. Small groups of protesters shouted insults as he left the courthouse. This Van Dyke, who's out on bail, that officer we're talking about.
Interesting stuff. And yes, like you said, another story, and there's just so many of them. We were just talking off air about why we don't really spend too much of our time, you know, we definitely are trying to bring you the information about the police state and, you know, police issues and things like that. But as far as, do we actually read every single one of these stories every time you see a man killed by a police officer or shot in the back or all the, you know, just different things like
there's too many of them.
You can't keep up with them, really.
And then some of the ones that you end up clicking on, you're just like, oh my God, I really wish I hadn't seen that, you know. Some of them, like, it's weird because you can see all this horrible, horrible stuff in, I don't know, video games and TV and stuff, but for some reason when it's, you know, cops tasering pregnant women and things like that, you can't really bear it. Because I think, you know, that's the point, is it does, you know, it does bring, that's the power, you know, of these videos. It brings to the eye of a normal, average person some of these things that are really going on. And, you know, it's difficult to see. I mean, I've had to stop watching many of them, but I think that's kind of the point. And, you know, we're going to have these cameras now. Hopefully more and more police will have these cameras, so you'll have first-person view of this stuff on sometimes, you know. But nonetheless, you know, what are you going to do, you know? I guess these protesters in Chicago found something to do. And I'm sure they're not alone, and, you know, and like I said, you know, remember who's accountable and hold them accountable.
Absolutely. Moving on to another story that's affecting you domestically, I want to talk for a minute about the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is a controversial trade agreement that I'm imagining most of this audience is aware of, and if not, you are about to get an education. This international trade deal involves the economies of 12 different nations, including the United States, and about just over a quarter of the entire world's economy. And it's been discussed pretty much the entire Obama administration back and forth. You know, this is not something that you get a vote on. This is an international trade deal organized by trade ministers from each of the countries meeting in private, in secret. Only information we have about this stuff until they recently released the full text over the past couple of years has been released through WikiLeaks and hackers and people like that who've been giving us previews of various chapters. And as the discussion has gone on, it's basically got to the point where a fast track bill passed earlier in this year, which basically gives the lawmakers a vote of yes or no once it actually gets through. So now all the international discussion has taken place. The agreements have been made. Now we're in this period where the public is supposed to be viewing, although most of the public is unaware of this, public is supposed to be viewing the text of the document, and then the earliest Obama could sign it into law after Congress gives it a yes or a no vote would be February 4th, 2016. So that's coming up soon. We're in this period, like I said, where the full text is available. And there's been some good reports, including one from journalist James Corbett, released an excellent report examining the effects of the proposal. He says that the most egregious portions relate to the ISDS, Investor State Dispute Settlement Mechanism, intellectual property and food safety standards. And definitely, you know, we're going to be posting all these links on the Freethinker Radio Facebook page and on the HoustonFreethinkers.com as well, so you can do more to look into this. But essentially the dangers in this, the big one with ISDS, is it gives corporations who are doing international business with these nations, say that they commit some kind of violation in the United States and you want to sue them. And you do sue them in a successful lawsuit, and they lose, and they owe you money for polluting in your, you know, your land or whatever, something, whatever the violation may be. They can then appeal that decision to an international tribunal, and that decision could be overridden, and then they would no longer face consequences domestically. So that's obviously dangerous for...
So an action in our life, you know, that would normally be the power of government, is going to happen, and... we're not going to have any representation. So we're going to have government without representation, basically.
There will be no representation,
yep,
but it'll be on the international level this time. And, you know, this seems like some faraway kingdom. Just, you know, if they don't agree with the decision, they'll just appeal it to the tribunal, and they can get away with all sorts of things. Recently, the Electronic Frontier Foundation released a report. The EFF wrote, "Everything in the TPP that increases corporate rights and interests is binding, whereas every provision that is meant to protect the public interest is non-binding and is susceptible to getting bulldozed by efforts to protect corporations." So that's a little bit of background on this. I'm going to give you a little bit more in just a moment, but the reason I bring this up is because just last week, the Washington Post had an interview with Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, and he said that he does not support the idea of voting on the TPP before the 2016 election. Quote, "It certainly shouldn't come before the election. I don't think so. I have some serious problems with what I think it is. But I think the president would be making a big mistake to try to have that voted on during the election. There's significant pushback all over the place. We will continue working with the congressional leaders to pass the TPP as soon as possible next year," says a White House spokeswoman. So they're going back and forth as far as like if they're actually going to do it or not. And who knows, they may still push it. And Obama has said for his part that this is something he wants to be a part of his legacy. You know, he he's not satisfied with just having the legacy of NSA surveillance, Guantanamo torture, force feeding, drone bombing, expanding wars, expanding surveillance powers. He has to get in the TPP. So, I mean, he's trying to set a record.
Hey, man, he's granting 95 Christmas time pardons, okay? Man.
I saw that. I almost forgot about all the drone bombings when I saw that.
I know. It filled me with such a Yule spirit.
I was like, oh, Christmas.
Nice. Yeah, he's letting off some counterfeiters and some people with bank fraud. And, somebody with 15 gun crimes and... different things like that. So, I think it's nice to have like this check and balance where a president can, pardon people. But at the same time, a lot of these people were victims of the war on drugs, might not have necessarily been victim or might not have had, might not have been perpetrating a crime where there's a victim like the counterfeiters and the bank fraud people and such. But yeah, it nearly made me forget that Guantanamo is still going on,
Yeah, he hasn't been able to get that one done. But if you want to see more information on this, we'll post this, like I said, on the HoustonFreethinkers.com. We haven't done it the last couple weeks, but we're getting better. This week we will have, if you go to the website tonight, there will be a post that says Freethinker Radio with today's date, and it'll have a link to all the stuff we played, all the songs. We'll try to remember them, or I'll go through and listen again and put them in there. So if you want to catch up with the artist, if you want to catch up with the news, you can do that. And once again, I want to remind you guys that this is KPFT Houston, and there is a year-end gift drive going on. If you want to support this community-driven, commercial-free, listener-supported radio, you can go to kpft.org and make a donation, or if you want to call in. And of course, if you just want to call in general to talk to us about any of the topics you're hearing today, 713-526-8737. And yeah, we'll be posting all the news in there. It's the top of the hour, so let's go to another song and then come back with some more news for you guys. This is Freethinker Radio, 90.1 KPFT Houston. Stay tuned.
Where am I now?
Welcome back to Freethinker Radio. My name is Derek Brose.
Yeah, my name is Micah Jackson, and the names of those bands were Crashing Colors and definitely Jeremy Carswell. I hope you enjoy that music that was from Jeremy's new album, 2025, that just came out. Shout out to him. Shout out to all the great musicians. And if you are a great musician or know great musicians, then recommend their work to us. We'd love to find new music. We love to share new music, and that's just one facet of what we do here on Freethinker Radio, but we take it very seriously. And thank you. So what you thinking, Derek?
I got some more news. Before I dive into that, though, I want to throw out just a couple of shout-outs as well myself to some people who've posted recently on the Houston Freethinkers Facebook page. I don't want to say this guy's name in case he doesn't want to say his name, but a gentleman posted, said, I'm a 53-year-old, born and raised in Houston. I wanted to start a group just like this, so I'm really glad you are here. Hey, we're glad you're there.
Yeah, definitely. It makes a world of difference. You know, I there's a lot of critics, and not just the positive critics that tell us, you know, how to do things better, but the haters, you know. But it's nice to hear occasionally the people that just appreciate what we're doing, because we're going to do it, period, because we appreciate it. But to hear that it means something to someone else means the world. So thank you so much. And you know, if you want to help, definitely share the stuff from Freethinker Radio, share from our page, like our page, find us out there, help others to find their way here, and we can make this a better community resource for everyone. So
yeah. And also one more shout out before we get back to the news. Shout out to Crystal Sherrill, who you may hear us play throughout Freethinker Radio, throughout our shows. We've played her in the past, and she has performed at Freethinker events before as well. But she also commented on the Facebook page, and last week, if you listened, you heard us briefly mention Asada Shakur, and Crystal Sherrill said, I heard the brief mention on the show, and you said it would take an entire episode. You are right, it would. So many people don't know about her, and I think it would be good. So just wanted to let you know, we heard that, we saw that, and we're definitely considering that for future episodes. And if you ever have a suggestion for something we should cover, if you know guests, people in Houston or even outside of Houston who are working on important things, who need an audience and are working on positive solutions or just got information that needs to be shared, you can contact us via the Freethinker Radio Facebook page or the Houston Freethinkers Facebook page, and through the HoustonFreethinkers.com as well.
And you can call 713-526-8737 and talk to us about it. At
Who's
least for a little
be
while.
Our first caller?
Someone's got to call.
Somebody has to go ahead and do it. You know, somebody out there
I'm
listening
start,
right
like,
now.
Calling people out.
They're looking at their cell phone. They're like, "Huh, I could do it. What am I going to say? If I'll be on the radio. What am I? It's okay. You can do it. You'll be okay. We promise.
Yes.
But you don't have to yet. But the lines are open if you want to call in.
We think the lines are open.
We think we're still doing
You've been
this.
Trying
so
to call,
calling in,
message us, because we don't know if we're making a mistake.
Shoot
here.
Us a text if you're trying to call in and we're ignoring you.
Yeah,
we think we were looking at this machine right, but until we figure it out or until otherwise,
until we get a call,
we're going to continue with the news. So thank you guys
yes,
for being patient.
Don't rely on one channel of communication. Reach out, make it happen.
Reach out to us in any way you need.
And definitely go ahead while we're shouting out Facebook pages and stuff like that. Like all the musicians that you like, and go ahead and like the KPFT page, because they've got all kinds of events going on and things to be involved in that are far beyond just this one show. Much love to them.
Much love to everyone at KPFT. And, of course, remember, they are having a year-end gift drive. If you want to support them, go to kpft.org so you can support community-funded, commercial-free radio. On with the national news. You may have heard us discuss last week, and if you're listening to Freethinker Radio, you're tuned into our airwaves, then you got a preview before anybody else. We were telling you last week that this government shutdown that they were wanting everybody to be afraid of, that it was coming and it was impending doom and we must pass this bill. We mentioned two things that might get passed within there, and one of them was the Monsanto rider, the GMO labeling bill. That one, fortunately, did not get through. And I say fortunately, not because I'm pro-GMO or one way or the other, but because I'm pro people having a time to discuss and hear about these issues. And this was just another sneaky way for them to take a big important issue and pass it along, a bill that they have to pass, you know. But unfortunately, the other one we told you about, the surveillance bill, CISA, Cyber Security Information Sharing Act, one of those versions of that bill, there was three versions as of last week, they were able to combine them all into one, add it as a provision, and I think now it ended up being called the Cybersecurity Act of 2015. And it is apparently, just as we talked about last week, not only is it's not voluntary, and it's giving these companies who decide to share information based on very vague and broad language as far as what, you know, what a threat is, what a terrorist is, then those companies are immune from lawsuits from individuals like you and me who later discover, hey, I trusted this company and they shared my information with the government even though I was doing nothing wrong. They will not be held accountable. Well, this bill by Justin Amash and Senator Rand Paul, Thomas Massie of Kentucky, and others basically said that this is one of the worst anti-privacy bills since the Patriot Act, and that it was snuck in there, you know, last minute while people aren't paying attention on under a bill that, you know, like I said, it has to pass, right? This funds the government from now till November 2016. So most people would say we need the government funded. There's people's jobs on the line, et cetera, et cetera. So it's easier for them to get this through. I'm going to read you another quote from here. This is from Representative Justin Amash of Michigan. He told truthinmedia.com he does not support the bill. It's the worst anti-privacy vote in Congress since the Patriot Act. Thomas Massie on Facebook posted, "We learned last night that in addition to unsustainable spending, the giant omnibus includes completely unrelated legislation to expand warrantless domestic cyber surveillance and to repeal country of origin labeling for meat sold in the U.S. I will be voting no on Thursday." That was on Thursday. This did pass on Friday. And Amash said that he believes the surveillance provisions were quietly slipped into the massive bill in an attempt to, quote, avoid full scrutiny. We take an oath to defend the Constitution, and our Fourth Amendment privacy protections are as important as anything, he said. So that's something that got that was added to there, and I'm sure there's going to be more things. You heard them mention that the meat. I heard other people complain about the repeal country of origin labeling for meat sold in the U.S. So if you're worried about meat coming from a specific country and what may be done to it, whether it's antibiotics or other contaminants, you will no longer know because
or how it's raised.
Yeah, or what you know what. It was treated and all those kind of things. That information will not be provided to you. So that's important. Now, as far as on the solutions end, what can we do as individuals who are watching this surveillance be built up around us? And I think it's pretty safe, and there's no hyperbole here to say that we're in a surveillance state. I mean, when you have, we can list off more than 10 federal institutions, federal only, you know, we're not even talking about the state and local institutions, who have these type of tools, then I think it's pretty clear that we're dealing with mass surveillance on a scale never before quite seen. And it's difficult to find a solution, you know, within that other than to continue to educate yourself about that, to be smart and aware of the things that you discuss in front of computers, cell phones, and around other people. I guess if you have things that you don't want somebody to hear, you probably shouldn't put them online or in a text message anywhere.
Yep, you're not safe in your effects or in your papers. Imagine that. You are not safe. Even though you should be respected as a human being, you are not. So, you know, I guess that's just how it goes. You know, you also brought up the, I guess it was $1.1 trillion in taxes just to keep the government running till 2016, you know. That's interesting because, you know, that's not the only thing. People think, okay, that's the only taxes the government takes. Well, you're insane if you think that's the only taxes that the government, you know, takes because, heck, the same week, a $622 billion tax package was passed as well. The bill was approved 318 to 109 vote, 241 Republicans joining, 77 Democrats in backing the measure. At the end of it all, you know, they said Justin Amash voted against it. Some others voted against it. But, you know, it's just smashing right through, you know. And basically, one thing about this bill is that it permanently renewed a range of tax provisions from following years and short-term extensions and extended that for different people permanently for different situations. Also, the Joint Committee on Taxation estimated that the bill's cost would be $622 billion over 10 years and that tax provisions in the bill would cost an additional $58 billion over 10 years. So, you know, you've got this tax bill, $622 billion, and you got these additional tax provisions for $58 billion, and you've got the omnibus. So, you know, it's just
mind-boggling to try and understand those numbers, you know, just the size of them. Size of the amount of money that is going into.
Well, you can add up the ones that are taxes and divide them, you know, by like the payers and find out certain things, also what they go to. So, yeah, it is mind boggling. And, you know, that it consumes so much, you know, we don't even, I guess there's a lot more waste, fraud and abuse than people think. I mean, really.
So the next story I want to cover has to do with once again, surveillance, and I guess I tend to harp on surveillance quite a bit.
Well, it's just it's one of the issues that comes and goes.
It's definitely an issue that does come and go, and it's, you know, since Edward Snowden, since 2013, I think surveillance has been on the minds of many Americans as we learn the full scope of the surveillance state I was just mentioning. And one of the issues that I've been really keen on, and I mentioned this earlier, is Stingray cell phone surveillance. And I was discussing how on the 21st of January, the Houston Freethinkers and the American Civil Liberties Union will be co-hosting a presentation called Houston Under Watch, a discussion on surveillance. And it'll be an update on a presentation I gave last year that exposes the Houston Police Department's use of Stingray cell phone surveillance tools, also known as cell site simulators, and a number of other tools. So I'm going to be taking the presentation I did that year, collecting everything new we've learned since then, and then also releasing some new details, as I said, once I get the documents back from HPD, and also new information about surveillance planes flying over the city. So I've been preparing for that, and then out of nowhere, some really awesome individual within the intelligence community decided to release a catalog of these tools to the Intercept website. A new whistleblower has leaked a catalog of cell phone surveillance devices used by the military, intelligence agencies, and local police departments, including the controversial Stingray spying tool. The release of a secret U.S. government catalog of cell phone surveillance devices has revealed the names and abilities of dozens of tools previously unknown to the public. The catalog shines a light on well-known devices like the Stingray and DRT Box, as well as new names like Cellbrite, Yellowstone, Blackfin, Maximus, Stargrazer, and Cyberhawk. The Intercept reports that within the catalog, the NSA is listed as a vendor of one of the devices, while another was developed for use by the CIA, and another was developed for a special forces requirement. Nearly a third of the entities focus on equipment that seems to have never been described in public before. And as I said, you've heard us report on this for a while now, both through Freethinker Radio and through just our actions and our events. This device can be, as now these days, it can be something that you wear. It can look like a little briefcase. It can be mobile. It can be installed in a police vehicle. And it tricks your phone into thinking that's a cell phone tower, so your phone connects to it, and it can then steal most of the content of your phone. The newer devices, the ones that we're dealing with, this next generation that are kind of being called Kingfish and Hailstorm, these ones are actually capable of cracking the 4G LTE encrypted networks for your newer phones. Those you guys who are on the 4G LTE networks, that means it's encrypted. These phones, this device basically forces you to downgrade to the old network, so then you're unencrypted and they can hack your information. So
I want a phone that's in a phone, that, like, so that, so, you know, I go into places or I go, you know, outside my lead fortress of solitude, and I hit the button, let them know that, you know, I'm out in the real world, and it switches to the other phone that's inside the phone. So this other phone inside the phone is just full of a whole bunch of strange leads that just send them like research and all kinds of crap, because they shouldn't be stealing and looking in weird places anyway. You know, I think that'd be a cool app, you know, basically just an app full of junk to just like constantly be uploaded to anything that's like hitting your phone for stuff.
There definitely are some devices out there, and this is one of the things that I plan to talk about further in the discussion. You can look up things like Red Phone, Black Phone, look up Whisper Systems. There's chat apps, there's, you know, messaging apps, and, you know, do your research. It's about as much as, it depends on what level of trust you want to give to these companies. Does that mean that, you know, I'm sure they're made.
Oh, it goes off like a flag. Like, all of a sudden, you wanted to be able to talk private. What the hell's wrong with you?
Somebody,
see, now we monitor you more.
That you're looking up encryption. And no, honestly, though, since Paris, let's be real about this, since the Paris attacks and since San Bernardino and everything, this increase in calls for terrorism, it's like we're back at 9/11 and there's more. They want to pass surveillance bills. They want to, you know, they're pushing all the fear and paranoia. You've had the police chiefs, the biggest organization of police chiefs in the United States and the biggest organization of attorney generals, come together and say that they want the lawmakers to pass legislation that would make it illegal for you to encrypt your phone, because they're saying, oh, the terrorists are plotting using encryption. So they're really having this push against encryption, and the Stingrays are definitely a part of that.
See, encryption and privacy equal terrorism.
If you want privacy, you must be a terrorist, is the message that we're getting here. Here's some new details that we got out of these documents, though, for those who want to know more about these tools. Because some of these, I mean, really, it's just astounding. But if you think about that, most of these devices came from military equipment and then were adapted to local law enforcement, just like with many things, then this makes sense. CellBrite is a portable, handheld, field-proven forensic system for the quick extraction and analysis of 95% of cell phones, smartphones, and PDA devices, capable of extracting information such as phone book, pictures, videos, text messages, and call logs. Kingfish is a stingray-like device that is portable enough to be carried around in a backpack. I love the way they advertise these things.
So handy.
Stargrazer, an army system developed... Now, check this one out. This guy's a beast. Developed to deny, degrade, and or disrupt a targeted adversary's command and control system, which can jam a handset and capture its metadata at the same time it pinpoints your target.
So
location.
Can we do this? Like, can I just do this if I want to? Can I run around and, stingray up some cops and politicians and stuff?
This is how it works, and this is something else that I point on this article, is that... So Harris Corporation, they're the manufacturer of this in Melbourne, Florida. They make these devices along with maybe one other company, but they're definitely the majority of these devices come from them. Then they work with the FBI and say, okay, anybody who wants to contract with us, local law enforcement or whatever, has to sign non-disclosure agreements in order to get access. So Houston Police Department wants to go get these devices like they do. They spend a couple $100,000 and HPD has the Stingray too. So then they buy that. They have to sign a non-disclosure agreement with the FBI and with the Harris Corp to not talk about it. So us as an individual, these manuals are, as you've seen, a whistleblower had to leak it for us to even get access to this information. So these aren't available for you, the average person, to go do that. And in fact, there's been Houston news stories ran where the HPD kind of pushed, I felt like they were pushing some reverse propaganda. They're like, well, we're worried about what happens if this gets into the hands of an individual and they're going, you know, doing what you're talking about. Because theoretically,
it's usually the people who want guns that want people not to have guns. And the people who want to get in your phone that wants you not to get in their phone, and I just don't understand it.
If you've got a little bit of knowledge and some time on the internet, what I've been told by people more technically savvy and knowledgeable than I have, then you know, this is something you can make for a few thousand dollars. And there was a presentation by this guy, his name escapes me, but he's one of the leading researchers on this.
He basically did
a Skillshare for Congress. It was funny. They were having like a Senate hearing, and he brought one up, and in the middle of the meeting, like, told the senators what their numbers were because he had just pinged their phones. And it was like, okay, so y'all are 713, whatever, and they're sitting there like, okay, maybe we should pay attention to these devices. So that's the Stargrazer. One more, Cyberhawk, which is capable of gathering your phone book, names, SMS media files, text, deleted text messages,
not the deleted ones,
and notes from 79 cell phones at once. Cyberhawk, check that guy out. So Jennifer Lynch, of staff attorney at the Electronic Frontier Foundation, says, we've seen a trend in the years since 9/11 to bring sophisticated surveillance technologies that were originally designed for military use back home to the United States. And, of course, the Justice Department spokesperson swears that they, quote, use technology in a manner that is consistent with the requirements and protections of the Constitution, including the Fourth Amendment and applicable statutory authorities. So the surveillance battle continues. And as I said earlier, it should be pretty obvious we're in a police/surveillance state. And anyone who's aware of this should just continue to educate themselves and their communities about these tools and support initiatives by individuals who are developing apps and other ways of, at the least, you know, there are some apps. There's one called Snoop Snitch that you can...
Snoop Snitch?
I think it works for an Android.
I like that name.
That will allow you to... It's like these are IMSI's catchers. Then you have a catcher detector, and we talked about this.
Yes.
It's like the catcher detector. So the catcher detector will at least alert you. You know, theoretically, it would be like an app that shows you all the cell towers in your area. And if all of a sudden one of those cell towers is mobile, then it's not a cell tower.
Yeah, because they don't move.
Because they don't move. And, you know, some other little piece of information that I'm going to share with you real quick.
It's following you, the cell tower.
If you're ever at a protest and you see the cop cars out there, like they come in full force, and for whatever reason you notice that your cell phone signal is full, it's like at full capacity, that could be a sign that your phone is being targeted because it locks on your phone and makes you go to full signal, and then that also kills your battery faster. So if you notice that full signal, battery dying faster, calls being interrupted, calls being dropped, inability to make calls, those are signs that you might be...
That sounds like every day.
Those are signs that you might be dealing with Stingray cell phone surveillance.
You might have a...
You might have a Stingray in your phone. I want to cover one more, and I think we're going to cut to a break and come back. Mike has got an interview that he wants to play. This one, though, I'll get through this one briefly, and then when we come back from the interview at the end of the show, we'll do a little bit of international news. And, of course, the phone lines are open, 713-526-8737, if you've got anything to add here on Freethinker Radio on 90.1 KPFT Houston. This story is one I'm actually in the middle of writing, so you'll get the preview here. But some researchers with... I need to look up the name of this organization. 1 second. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration.
Oh, yes. I think I've seen this one.
The National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration's Earth System Research Laboratory in Boulder, Colorado. Professor there, Charles Long, he says that he believes we might, quote, we might actually be conducting some unintentional geoengineering here, he said at a press conference this week at the American Geophysical Union fall meeting in San Francisco. So first of all, what is geoengineering? Geoengineering is the science of manipulating the weather in a way to deliberately affect the Earth's climate.
Like a rain dance.
Some people say that this is, you know, this has been proposed as a way to combat global warming, climate change, etc. There's a bunch of different ways to geoengineer. You can repeat, try to mimic the volcanic ash. There's SRM, which is solar radiation management, which involves spraying aerosols out of planes to scatter or reflect sunlight to reduce the amount of heat trapped by greenhouse gases. So there's a number of different ways that they've proposed to do this, and it's very controversial because, you know, of all the different sciences, basically people are saying, well, look, we have impending doom coming. Humans are not making quick enough moves. They're not willing to change their behavior. So we might have to use science to, you know, manufacture the weather to combat the climate, to save the planet. And so this is something that I personally have kept an eye on. And then, you know, we're going to be in both worlds here for a minute, and let's see if you can handle this. We're going to be in a world that exists in the conspiratorial side and the mainstream accepted science. Geoengineering is not a conspiracy. It's a science that exists that talks about managing and altering the weather, but it reportedly is in the theoretical, the research phase, and some of those studies that have been done have shown that if we are to start messing with the weather, geoengineering the weather through solar radiation management, through spraying things out of planes to reflect sunlight, it could cause a loss of blue skies. It could cause more hazy skies. It could cause inadvertent effects. Say maybe we cool down the temperature in one area, but then all of a sudden the desert, you know, another area turns to desert. So we have no idea to really know how we're affecting the climate. And they've also said that once you start geoengineering, you basically can't stop without causing rapid heating up of the planet. So now, again, step over to the conspiratorial side. There are those who believe that this has already been taking place, and like many programs in the past, the U.S. government and corporations just are not alerting to the public of it, because something like geoengineering, you can't really, there's no contained earth that you can go test it on. You have to basically put it in the field and, I guess, see how it goes. And so some people believe these programs are already existing. So those are two different worlds, right? Geoengineering exists, weather modification exists, and some people believe that this science is not theoretical, is not in the research phase, but is actually happening. So then this story is from the Charles Long, the guy from the NOAA, National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. He's saying, well, the planes that are flying over the skies, which they typically call contrails, in which the researchers and believers in geoengineering theory would say, hey, no, that's quote-unquote chemtrails or geoengineering. Well, this guy says, whatever you want to call them, we might actually be unintentionally geoengineering here. So he's saying the planes that are flying overhead that you see every day, those lines in the sky, that is typical standard contrails, nothing to worry about, but they may be inadvertently also doing what people think they are doing. Already. I don't know if that made sense, if I got that all across there. I know it's kind of a complex situation, nuanced situation, especially if you've never looked into it before. But that's just, it's astounding to me, somebody who, like me, who does think that there's something to look into as far as geoengineering goes. And you have some people who say, look, those lines that I see in the sky, those aren't even, they're not even flying to the airports. They're doing different crisscross patterns. That's not a, you know, that's not a standard flight route, you could say. And even if it is, so even if you do think that what you see every day is contrails,
the effect, it might not be,
it might
different.
Be, yeah, the effect might be no different and maybe having the same outcome.
But like, you could be wrong. They really could be contrails doing that. So I'd like the way you've introduced that, because it, you know, I think a lot of the times that's the way, you know, situations are. You, in this one, you're talking about the conspiratorial and then the scientific. Well, you know, there's always, you know, the ideas we have, the knowledge we have, is often the best theory at the time. And, you know, people have different reasons for believing things. And if they don't have the one that they can adequately explain to someone else and persuade them to see that, then, you know, it doesn't necessarily mean that the theory that they're postulating, the result that they believe is happening, isn't happening. It's just not happening the way they believed it was happening. So I think all that's really interesting, you know, because we... everything's not figured out yet, you know, and often we live in such an advanced state that we believe everything's figured out already and everything's just fine. And
I want to just read this last bit here, and then we can move on to Micah's interview. So this says, as the contrail, and this is coming from the SmithsonianMag.com, this article, original article. As the contrail dissipates, it leaves behind a thin, icy haze. The sky may appear cloud-free, but the particles are there until they fall out of the atmosphere. And while in the sky, they scatter the sun's light in a similar way as in the proposed geoengineering projects. Kevin Trenberth of the National Center for Atmospheric Research says, it seems quite possible that what they're seeing is that they're seeing something that's real. But he also warns there's a lot more work to be done before they can verify this and make a connection to the climate. And then just the last piece to add to this is there was a researcher, a professor from Berkeley University, who wrote a brief blog following the Paris Climate Conference and basically saying the goals of the Paris Agreement cannot be achieved without geoengineering. And so he anticipates that we're going to hear more discussion on geoengineering. Specifically, he says, injecting aerosols into the stratosphere or solar mirrors. So find out more about geoengineering, look into that topic, and look for that article coming soon on theantimedia.org. We're going to go to a song, and then we're going to plug in this interview that Micah did. Set up the interview for us, Micah. What's...
Yeah, definitely. I just... you know, there's a lot of things going on in culturally in Houston. There's art things, there's music things, etc. Obviously, we care a lot about music. So a person who's come by and DJed a show with us before, knew us from a show, stuff like that, reached out and asked for some support on a show he had going on. And I said, you know, let me talk to you about that show. So basically, you know, nothing heavy here, no science or conspiracy or truth or magic or anything like that. Just some people hanging out at Chill Vibes over at Midtown and talking about this upcoming show. And he has this interesting guy with him. I think it's Heavy the Blue, a producer and rapper that he brought in that also did a surprise set, and people were just amazed. So, you know, it's something different, and you know, we'd like to mix it up. So that's what this interview will be about, and we're just gonna play a short song and then get into this, and then we'll be back and we'll wrap it up.
Awesome. Stay tuned. You're listening to Freethinker Radio on KPFT Houston. We're gonna go to a quick song from Mark Andaya, and then we'll play that interview from Micah. Thank you.
Like you were getting ready for the storm which to come, and the day is going on, and the days go on and on. Pages turn and another bright soul seems to be gone, it seems to be gone. This life to whom it belongs, can you feel where I'm coming from? All my friends, don't delude yourselves, we all dwell in the temple so well. Each and one of us, I say, reflect a divine resemblance. Oh, 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 transition, honeybee, you are. You gather the nectar of unity. Oh, 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 transition, honeybee, you are. Transcending all plurality. The given story unravels, behold. You are not young, nor are you old. This body will crumble and die, but subject to change is not the nature of I. You can get to know yourself, you can know the story of stories, yeah. Free from I-ness and minus, because you give them, light to shine. You reflect to your mind, but in a humble reside. You give them, you give them light to shine. So I keep on smiling, dear. When I want to move forward in a decision, make sure you're stepping in the right direction. This life can only be a given blessing if you see the one heart connection. Ooh, yeah. You give light to them, you give light to them. It's a hum, it's ever shining. Oh, oh, oh. Transition, honeybee.
I'm Micah Jackson here with Freethinker Radio. I'm talking to Javier, DJ Hypo Electro. He's come through. We're live at Chill Vibes at Midtown Bar and Grill. Picking up on, we just saw Alicia Dieringer.
Alicia.
And she's on a show that you have coming up as well, right?
Yeah, man. January 1st at Edo's, we're going ahead and setting up a big show. You know, something that we're putting together by a bunch of different organizations that are helping us out. We got Oda, which is a big family that we created, and now we're branching off to bigger size. We got Elements, who's providing a lot of the production work, things like that. We got Boogaloo Zoo Crew. They're coming through. They're also broadcasting the show, which is going to be awesome. You also have Sakio Studios, who will be doing all the videography, photography, all of that. So just a bunch of different people came together, and we're trying to just change the scene in a way where we can bring quality sound, quality performances, you know, different action, you know, actually put a show and a party at the same time. Because from what I know, we're pretty rascals, you know, we can get a little wild. So we want to party, but at the same time, we want to put a show for the people, you know what I mean? Something that sticks in their head and is like, wow, like I had a blast, and at the same time, I got a performance. Like, what is it, you know? So that's what we're bringing in. We also have Heavy Blue, who's our main act for the show.
What's up?
Great producer. Great. I mean, he makes his own music. He's emceeing, you know, dropping down all the beats. Check him out.
Say a couple things.
Yeah, man.
Go by Heavy the Bluebird. Originally from San Antonio, Texas. You know what I'm saying? Been out here for like 8 months, seriously, getting this music down. Talking to you know, people that own venues, people that throw shows, getting down with Oda and Elements. And to complement what Javier was saying, just I feel like we're trying to provide people with not only, you know, a show and a party, but substance and something that, you know, this show coming up is a carnival-based show, and we're throwing something that's equally conceptual and, you know, also very ratchet, you know what I mean? So we really want to bring the structure and that natural energy together and allow people to really get live with us, you know, the same way that we want to for our shows, you know? Because, you know, that free thought, you know, that free expression and that dancing is something that we've always been really inspired by while we're playing, you know?
Yeah, that's what's up, man. And you came through and did a surprise set here tonight at Chill Vibes of all places. And what'd you think about that as far as the audience?
It was beautiful. I got a lot of love, like a lot of love, a lot of love. And that's another reason why I love Houston so much, is just because they have love for art. And when you're an artist that spends all of your time curating and really, you know, putting their all into this, it becomes like the most, like the greatest gift when someone actually like listens to you and supports you and likes what you're doing, you know what I mean? Because this is seriously all I do outside of working to make money, you know what I mean? And this is really all that we care about as a whole, besides, you know, our families and our personal lives, you know what I mean? This is
I definitely know what you mean, and I want to definitely support. And I think that's a big part of what we try to do with both Freethinker Radio, HFT, and more is you know, get out there, support people being themselves, getting their art out there, like whatever it is that they do. Some people do videography, some people do write articles, some people spit lyrics, some people do different things. Whatever it is you do, get out there, man. You'll find your tribe, and that's like, you know, you came out tonight, and we didn't know who you were, and you just did it and fit in, and everybody loved it.
Yeah.
And and that's what's up, and that's what you're talking about, is like come out, have some culture, have a little bit of content, some real experience, but have a good time, because if you're not having fun, you're not doing it right.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, some stagnant, here's what the culture is what we've had. We've had enough of that.
Exactly.
So, like, I hate to ask you again, but can you spell it out real quick where we can find more about what you got going on here in January, so everybody knows exactly where to find it?
Yeah, just check us out on Facebook. That's mainly place we're going ahead and promoting at the moment. We have our main page on there. It's called Elements, introducing Heavy the Bluebird.
And you spell that as Elements, like normal?
It's actually E-L-I-M-E-N-T-S.
There it is. That's exactly where you find it.
Like Elite, you know what I'm saying? Elite, miss. You know what I'm saying? L-E-I. Yeah. L-E-I-M-E-N-T-S. You can find us on Facebook.
You go ahead and look that up on Facebook. You'll find the event page. You'll find our page as well. All the information, all the other groups that are going to be involved in the show is also going to be there. So you can get a lot of information from us there. And like he was was saying, I mean, we're bringing together a lot. That's why we pretty much started calling ourselves Elements. And it's, we're bringing in dancers. We're bringing in people who put craft and time into videography, photography. You know, it's not just we're just getting some regular videographer. We're getting videographers who care about what they're doing, who put style in behind it. You know, we're bringing MCs. We got acoustic players. And then we got a carnival theme. Like, so we're going to just go ahead and make it a blast for everybody, man. And hopefully from this, we can keep growing more into bigger shows.
And I agree with what you were saying about, you know, there's a lot of like people that are strung to their culture and a lot of hip hop artists specifically that maybe wouldn't embrace certain themes or different genres being mixed into their shows. But this is not at all what our mission is. You know what I mean? Our mission is not to convey a repetitious and visceral art. You know what I mean? Like this is more organic than that. And it's beautiful watching, you know, us grow together. That's what has birthed all of this. You know what I mean? It's not about
people
even the
aren't
music.
That simple. It's like we were having that song conversation earlier. People aren't that simple. Yeah. You know, if you look at yourself, you've been moved by all kinds of music when you were a young child.
Exactly.
It moved you to tear up. It moved you to want to fight. It moved you to want to dance. It moved you somehow before you even knew what a freaking genre was.
Yeah.
And you're working to do this to get people out of their comfort zones, to make them identify with something. That's something that, you know, we work really hard to do. So I feel like we're kindred spirits in that.
Definitely.
We're moving forward. I think we already said where to get the information about the show, where to find more about you as an artist. Did we get your information out as an artist?
I mean, you can
find you as an artist.
Yeah, you can Google Heavy, the Bluebird, and find everything. My Facebook, SoundCloud, Bandcamp, all of that. And again, that's Heavy the Bluebird.
That's great. I want to make sure everybody can find this stuff so when they like it, and we'll be playing some of this music in the show today.
Definitely.
But one other thing, I want to ask y'all: what artists locally or regionally? First, if you can, have you been moved by? We were talking about being moved by music. What artists that aren't mainstream move you?
Here in Houston, I've seen a lot. Chamba, I think you had him one time at your...
Yeah, Chamba's great.
Chamba, dude, like, I saw his performance, and he was... I think it might have sparked there, but, I mean, it also sparked a couple other performances. And with Chamba, it was just like, this guy here, like, the performance he puts on is a show. You know what I mean? He puts on a real, actual show. And I saw how he interacted with the crowd. I saw how he got everybody involved, how he just looked at the crowd. He got people to randomly MC with the crowd. So things like that, it made me like, all right, we got to put something like this together. And then I saw everybody that I had around me, my team, you know, the older family, all of that. And I was like, we can make it happen. Chamba was one of them. Alicia, when I started coming out to more open mics, I saw her and I was like, wow, acoustic players is like, that's another thing that doesn't, I don't think gets credit enough.
I agree. Yeah.
She got a beautiful voice too.
And when you come out more to this acoustic plays like that, you notice that and you see more of that and you're like, all right, I got to appreciate these type of people as well. That's why I got Alicia, put her on the show. I think she'd be a great opener for the show. And I mean, I got other acts like Live and Learn, another great guy. That's why I got him on my show as well. I saw him perform at House of Blues. That was amazing. I mean, Houston has some really great acts. It's just, like I was talking to somebody else, this is a big melting pot, and you kind of just got to go out there and find them. You know what I mean? If you can go out there, you'll find some great people, great talented artists. It's just about you wanting them.
Yeah, getting up off the couch and going out and discovering it. And hey, you know, I hate to say this because I never want a sponsor sitting on the couch, but you can explore the music. You can go to these websites. You can explore the music. You don't have to accept what you're being fed. And I encourage you to do that, even if you can't get off the couch. I really appreciate you sharing the artists that you found motivating. One of the things we like to ask people, and this may seem a little different, but it's really deeply tied to what you're talking about expressing here and creating. And what does freedom mean to you?
Freedom, to me, I guess, be yourself. Be who you are. You know, I see a lot of people like, I can't do this, I can't do that. And it's like, honestly, you can do whatever you want as long as you put it in your mind and you work for it. You can do whatever you want, and that's the freedom we have that a lot of people don't understand they have. I really see that. I think everybody's blinded by like, oh, I got these issues, I got money problems, I got this, I don't have a job, I'm this. And honestly, it comes down to your mind. Like, if you can let your mind free, like you have it, free thinkers, if you can think free, I believe you have the freedom to do whatever you want to accomplish. That's my
idea. I appreciate hearing that, because I know that we have lots of desires, and I tend to think that we have different desires, you know, when we think about them with our minds, some of them we find out are really about us, and like they're there for a reason, so when we pursue them, we find more self-actualization. You know, you want to put on a good show, you put on a good show, people come to it, you see these people loving it, you see these artists being able to get expression out to people, and you see the growth, and you know, maybe you need other pieces of the machine, for lack of a better word, that you need to keep building the system that you're doing. I think that there's a reason that we have these desires to want to do this. Yeah. So when you say anything you want to do, some people could take that in a crazy way, but what we're talking about is what you really want, like in your being, your nature.
And that's the thing, like I hear a lot, is like all crazy thoughts started somewhere. Everybody's like, I want to be president of the United States. That's crazy, but guess what? You can make it happen if you want it. You know what I mean? Like, somebody thought about, yo, I want to fly. Guess what? Somebody invented an airplane.
Can I answer that question?
Yeah, definitely. Please, tell us what freedom means to you.
Yeah, freedom to me, you know, to second what he was saying, but to simplify it is, freedom is not accepting your setbacks as the only way, or not accepting your setbacks at all, or any culture, or any structure that you might know to be human, or that you might know to be thought about normally. It's about what you think, and freedom is not something that can be taken away from you by any means. You know, we're all born with the freedom to choose, no matter what structure we may live under. And that freedom in itself, you're not going to choose things that are supernatural, because you know that what is natural is going to be your real pursuit. You know that that's within you, that's instilled within you. Freedom is what's instilled within you that no one else can touch.
That's very well said. I appreciate that. Is there anything else you want to get out to our audience during this?
Yeah, definitely. Like I said, I'm Heavy the Bluebird. This is Javier, aka DJ Hype Electro. Man, we've been doing this music thing for a very, very long time. Upcoming artists, this and that, it means nothing.
I hope y'all are enjoying the interview with DJ Hyper Electro and Heavy the Blue. That was some good stuff coming out to you from them. And like they said, they got that show at Edo on the 2nd of January. And they're working, you know, doing it the way they can. And commend anybody out there doing it the way they can, because that's what it's about. Getting out there, doing your thing, doing yourself, getting that stuff out there. Don't be dependent on the lame stream, dead stream. You know, you can be part of the revolution of hearts and minds by doing something. You can spend your money at a farmer's market. Speaking of January 2nd, the Heights Epicurean Farmers Market will be taking place right over there off of Heights, I think, in 18th at that UMC there. But nonetheless, yeah, it's really important. We don't have to just accept
move to action.
Yeah, we don't. It's not just political, you know. I mean, it's everything. We don't have to accept the culture we're given. We can find new art. We can cultivate new culture. We can support different things. And I urge everybody to think of that, whatever that means to them, and try to put that dollar that they sweat for into that somehow.
Absolutely. This is Derek Bros here on Freethinker Radio, and you just heard Micah Jackson. You heard an interview he just did there. If you're just tuning in now, we'd like to invite you one more time to support KPFT, which is community-funded, listener-supported, commercial-free radio. We love this because we get to play music from our friends, music from people that we support. We get to play interviews from people that we meet in the community, interviews from journalists, interviews from important people doing important things. And we want you to recognize that this resource is as much yours as it is ours. If you're doing things out there, contact us. Let's give you a voice. Let's help give your project the light that they need. And you can always count on us to bring you the underreported news, as well as the news from the community that you won't hear elsewhere. And I've got two quick news items, and then we'll probably just reflect the last couple of minutes. And, of course, those lines are open if you want to call 713-526-8737. This is, of course, the third episode of Freethinker Radio on KPFT Houston. And if you want to be our first caller, we would love to talk with you. So please call in if you have something to say. This next story has to do with international issues, something that is definitely an issue you should be aware of as we are looking at escalation of proxy wars between NATO nations, Turkey, the United States, the West, over fighting over Syria, the battle to stop ISIS, and the changing roles of Russia and all of that. Recently, Secretary of State John Kerry said that the United States' goal is no longer regime change, so they're actually not trying to supposedly remove Assad, which is a pretty big change from the past couple of years, which is what the whole thing they said they needed to do to... that we needed to go in there in this quote-unquote civil war, in this conflict, and not only help the people, but ultimately their goal was to remove President Bashar al-Assad. Now the United States has changed their rhetoric and saying that that is no longer the goal. And so that situation is continuing to develop. They said they're willing to work with Russia. And then meanwhile, we have a prime minister of Turkey has come out and said that he is laying the blame of weapons and chemical weapons, apparently, getting through into Syria through the Turkish border, and that the Turkish government was aware of this. And this story I'm looking at has to do with that 2 years after chemical attacks were staged in Syria, even more evidence is emerging which demonstrates that the attacks were not only committed by Western-backed jihadists, but were facilitated by NATO members themselves. According to Turkey opposition member Erhan Erdem, for the Republican People's Party, a cover-up of Turkish involvement in terms of both the foreknowledge and the shipping of chemical weapons to terrorists operating in Syria. Erdem cites evidence from, quote, an abruptly closed criminal case. He told Russia Today that, quote, there is data in this indictment. Chemical weapon materials are being brought to Turkey and being put together in Syria in camps of ISIS, which was known as Iraqi al-Qaeda during that time. The case he is referring to is known as 2013/120, opened by the General Prosecutor's Office in Adana. According to RT, this investigation revealed that a number of Turkish citizens took part in negotiations with Daesh, otherwise known as Islamic State, representatives on the supply of sarin gas. He points out that by citing evidence in the case mentioned above, that wiretapped phone conversations clearly demonstrate that an al-Qaeda member and fighter had acquired sarin gas through Turkey. So this situation is continuing to develop, and this is, again, another topic that we could probably spend the entire show breaking down on. And maybe in the next couple weeks we'll have a guest. We'll reach out to some of our guests and see who might be more of an expert, have some expertise in that field, so we can bring you behind the scenes. But again, paying attention to the escalation of that conflict between the West and Russia, Iran, and Syria. On some areas, it seems like there's common ground being formed. In other areas, it seems like World War III might break out at any moment. And then sometimes you have to wonder if the whole dang thing is just a charade to keep people in fear. I don't know. It's hard to decipher between all of the misinfo, disinfo, and lies these days. But we do our best to keep you informed of the developing situations both at home and abroad. And this last story I want to cover, we're going to switch gears here. It's a little bit more lighthearted. This has to do with the top 15 animal rights stories of the year. And I like animals. Micah, do you like animals?
Yeah.
Animals are fun. I think everybody likes animals, right? Maybe some of you eat them, but they're still fun, right? They're still our friends. So this one is the top 15 animal rights stories of the year from around the world. And we're just going to breeze through some of these and just let you know what's happening with animals, because I think this is an important fight. And also, I think there was some news locally about people sticking up for animals that we'll get into in just a second. But New Zealand recognized animals as sentient beings, a landmark decision by the Kiwis set a precedent that other countries should follow. Netherlands bans wild animals in circuses. It is now illegal for wild animals such as lions, bears, elephants, and giraffes to be used in circuses in Netherlands. And this one says, bad news for SeaWorld. 103-year-old orca recently spotted thriving in the wild. And it goes into why that's bad news for SeaWorld. Namely, that SeaWorld says that the conditions that their orca wells in, that's standard. That's how they would, you know, the length of time that they live is standard, even if they're in the wild, which doesn't really seem to be the case. Hawaii to become the first U.S. state to ban wild animals from performing. SeaWorld's profits have plunged 84% as customers have deserted the controversial park, namely since that film Blackfish and also some protests earlier this year. John Stewart bought a New Jersey farm and is turning it into an animal sanctuary. SeaWorld is going to be ending its major orca whale, killer whale shows in San Diego in the next year or so. Costa Rica is planning to shut down its zoos and free the animals in captivity. Activists charged with criminal mischief for giving water to thirsty animals. Wow, that's pretty insane there. A New York court recognized, I remember seeing this one, New York court recognizes chimps as legal non-human persons. And that's another one that we could spend a whole show dissecting on non-human persons and what exactly what rights should be granted to a non-human person, or what rights are in general. And Germany becomes the first nation to ban chick shredding.
That just sounds horrible. Let's not go
chick shredding. Yeah, let's move forward. Number 12. Activists save... Oh, I remember this one. Activists save 1,000 cats on their way to be illegally slaughtered in China. Animal rights activists rescued more than 1,000 starving cats on their way to slaughterhouses in South China. The beginning of the end of zoos. Orangutan wins rights and fight for freedom in landmark case. I also remember this. The ruling sets a precedent for all future cases and could mean the end of captivity. It's related to, again, the status as non-human person. Ringling Brothers announces that they will stop using elephants in their circuses. 13 Asian elephants will continue to tour the company before retiring to Ringling's Center for Elephant Conservation in Florida by 2018.
Elephants are cool.
They have an elephant conservation center. I didn't realize that. University of Oklahoma to cease its baboon research by 2019. Look at that little baboon. He doesn't look like he wants to be in that cage. After receiving immense pressure from animal rights activists to cease animal testing, the University of Oklahoma plans to phase out baboon research by 2019. Boom. Those are your top 15 animal rights stories of the year, brought to you by Freethinker Radio. And yeah, that's pretty much what we've got to cover today, Micah. What's going on? What do you have going on this weekend? Anything?
Yeah, there's anything all kinds of things going on this weekend. Tomorrow's the winter solstice, you know, Woo. So shortest day, darkest day, and the return of the light, et cetera, et cetera. So that's pretty exciting. But yeah, there's a, like I said earlier, we were listening to Crashing Colors, and Romina's going to be doing a solo set out at Union Tavern. We listened to some other people as well. We heard Jeremy Carswell. He's going to be out there. But, you know, those aren't the only shows going on. There's definitely a lot more. And I'm actually just stalling for time while I open up my list.
I think that this week, it's a good weekend. We're going to be back at the Last Organic Outpost on Saturday if the weather's all good. If you want to come check out the Last Organic Outpost, get involved in some organic gardening. Yes, it's quote-unquote winter in Houston, but that doesn't mean anything. We can still grow food. We can still get out there. And if the weather's good, we'll be there Saturday at noon at Last Organic Outpost. They have pizza Saturdays. You can come get pizza from the garden and learn a little bit about gardening, one of the things we'll be doing. And, of course, next Tuesday, we will be hosting a documentary screening of Trudeau.
Wow. Yeah, that's a lot going on. And of course, you know, as we were talking to you earlier, we're at the end of the year, and they're doing the end of the year fun drive. Definitely, we have to support the station. There's a lot of expenses just to keep it on air. They have figures around here that state how high that is. And if you can't come through with a monetary gift, then please remember to go to kpft.org, because there's ways you can contribute simply through your grocery shopping without it costing you anything extra. And we want to do everything we can to help KPFT. There's a Blackie Pinko mouthing Pluto show at Walters Wednesday of this week, so that looks like a really good thing to check out. There's events going on at Summer Street, always in Houston. That's one thing I love about Houston. There's always stuff going on, but we're definitely got to wrap it up.
You will see us posting some more events throughout the week on Freethinker Radio. If you guys follow us on Facebook, Freethinker Radio, follow the Houston Freethinkers, follow 90.1 FM KPFT. You can find that and us on Twitter as well, and all the good stuff. And of course, we put out new videos on YouTube, so stay plugged into our channels. You can find us here again next Monday from 3 to 5 p.m. Bringing you the news and music you won't hear in the dead stream. That's all for now this week. As always, if you can hear this, you are the resistance.
Live free, think free, and you will be free.